also ran a community safety unit in London to provide support for sufferers of hate crime and domestic violence. He is a trustee of the Tropical Health and Education Trust, trustee of the Equalities and Diversity Forum, and is a member of the BBC's Charity Appeals Committee. He has also been the vice chair of Amnesty International and the British Institute for Human Rights, as well as a non-executive director of the London Primary Care Trust. Not So Cut Off is a really, in my opinion, a really beautiful research report on a project called Arts and Older People, which sought to alleviate social isolation and loneliness in older people through the arts, and was commissioned by Fermynwoods Foundation earlier this year, along with Arts Council of Northern Ireland. Our other speaker today is Sharon Paulger, who is the director of Arts for Health at Milton Keynes. Arts for Health works to actively improve health and well-being by providing opportunities for people to take part in the arts and to produce art in hospital and healthcare settings. In 2005, Arts for Health was commissioned by the Department of Health to examine the role of the arts in healthcare settings, and six disused courtyards at Milton Keynes Hospital were redesigned by artists working in collaboration with hospital users. In 2010, Arts for Health launched Arts on Prescription, a programme of free art workshops on referral for people who experience stress, anxiety and depression. Since the start of the programme, over 200 people have participated, and the evaluation indicates direct improvement on health and well-being. Last year, Arts for Health were awarded a grant by Milton Keynes Community Foundation to run their Do Good, Feel Good volunteer programme, in which artists worked in a new studio with older people who suffer from dementia, as well as their carers, and all members work together to create new art. Previously, Sharon was director of Interaction Milton Keynes, as a charity focused on improving life chances of people with support needs or disabilities, as well as those in challenging or vulnerable circumstances. So, David, I would like to invite you to start the conversation on art and loneliness.
Thank you very much. Well, as always, you missed out my A O levels in that. horrified. As it is a conversation, we're a relatively informal group, and I'm sure we wouldn't overrun. Do you mind if we do find out who's in the room? If you just say what your interest is, would you mind that?
I'm from the Royal Voluntary Service. Great. We have a local befriending service to try and cut down on isolation and loneliness amongst older people in Corby and Keynes.
I'm first going to know an artist based in Cambridgeshire. I have a background, past background in social work, so I kind of feel like my practice overlaps with some of my previous work.
I'm Sonia, I work for Corby and Council and supports housing, so it's interesting for us because we have quite a lot of healthy people that are still independent but can get quite lonely. So.
I'm Fermynwoods, I'm the chair of Fermynwoods Contemporary Art, and I'm interested in the subject because it's one that we as a board have been considering how we could develop practice to tackle issues of loneliness.
I'm Helen Moore, I'm Programme Manager for Maiden Corby, which is an Arts Council funded organisation.
I'm Gary Thomas, I'm from a small arts organisation based in Derby in London, there are only two of us. And we work mainly with experimental animation, and we've done a couple of projects in health care centres, including one with people with terminal brain cancer.
I'm Dalia Juni. My profession is I work as an economist, but I volunteer as a volunteer befriender with isolated older people. I've been doing that for the past 5 years, and most recently I volunteered with Magic Me.
I'm Lisa Nathwani. I'm a ceramic artist from Northamptonshire, and I work for Fermynwoods as one of the education coordinators as well. I'm particularly interested because my current interest is arts with mental health and movement. And I've just done a project with Arts in Health in Leicestershire. So working with people who've got postnatal depression, or maybe some lower depression from health issue, or physical health issues, or
I'm Yasmin Campbell, Director of Fermynwoods Contemporary Art. I'm particularly interested in this area, partly because we're all ageing, but also because arts, I feel, too often are used to solve problems where sometimes it's inappropriately done and quality goes out of the window. But I feel that the way that we as an organisation work is interested in linking artists and audiences. So if we can find people, work with people who are interested in having different kinds of conversations and maybe addressing issues around being alone, loneliness, isolation through artistic practice, then that would just really beautifully fit with what the organisation does, our mission, but also with people's needs.
Thank you for allowing me that. So a very expert group, actually. And it's interesting that it exemplifies something that we're interested in at the Baring Foundation, is that one of the main reasons why we have the programme about arts and older people is that often, not always, but often we feel there's two worlds that aren't interacting as much as would be good for the arts and for older people, and that's a world of older people services and a world of arts organisations. And most of what we've been doing in the last 7 years has hopefully been about bringing those together. And occasionally, in the same body, you have someone who's an artist who's got a professional interest in the area of older people as well. Baring Foundation, for those of you that don't know us, we used to be a very large foundation, but we've managed to become a very small foundation. And the bump in the road that we hit was something called Nick Leeson in 1995, when the bank that formed the Baring Foundation was terrifically generous, went bankrupt because of the so-called rogue trader.
But clearly we're going to focus on the arts, and our arts programme has been running since 2010 in its current form, and it's focused on arts and older people. I think it's the best decision we've made. It wasn't always an obvious decision. I think a lot of people felt, well, lots of older people are involved in the arts anyway. Why would you be prioritising older people? If you go to the theatre, sometimes you'll feel, well, the audience isn't diverse enough, and that not diverse enough is about younger people, not about older people. It's not really true, and part of that is what age you're actually talking about. So in my age, I'm 55, so there was a peak of interest in involvement in the arts up to and just beyond retirement, but after 70 that involvement in the arts declines dramatically, and older people become a very underrepresented group. I don't think there's been enough thought about why that is, but there is an interaction about health. So if you look at the chart about increasing disability, increasing problems with mobility, you would see a close correlation with that decline in involvement in the arts, and there's also issues of other sorts of access and of income. But we felt that arts and older people have been very much neglected as an issue, that particularly if you think of the Arts Council as the most important public funder, they've always been interested in arts and younger people. That's very good. There's a really strong reason why that should be the case, about creating a habit of involvement in the arts. But it needed to be counterbalanced. An interest in older people as well. So that's what we've been doing since 2010. And briefly, that programme has had a very major focus on partnerships with the Arts Council. So we have funding partnerships in all four countries. In Scotland, we fund a festival for arts and older people. Lunate. In Wales we fund residences at the moment in the fifth of the care homes in Wales. In Northern Ireland, you've heard about one of the things that we've done already, which is a report on the issue of loneliness and older people and the arts. But that's actually part of a much bigger grants programme and festival, the Arts Council. In England, we've concentrated on working care homes with the Arts Council England, and there will be a new programme launched in July. It's going to have a specific focus on social isolation and loneliness. It will be for venue-based arts organisations. So it can be any venue, but there does need to be a venue. And the point of that is about art going out from that venue into places where older people are. There are many examples. I was interested in talking about supported housing. That's absolutely definitely going to be a focus of what we're doing. I've already talked about care homes, but many other settings. We hear lots about work in healthcare settings shortly. And there's a big variety of other things that we'll do. It's about arts and older people. It's all on our website. There's a whole series of so-called strategic initiatives. One of them is about having a choir in every care home. There's another about older people's theatre, very burgeoning, quite new movement of older people's theatre companies. Quite a lot on the art on dance. I mean, there's very obvious benefits for dance in. We were talking about running and the arts a moment ago. The benefits for dance for older people are very obvious, but it shouldn't be reduced to purely a keep fit exercise. So examples of that and why it's different to talk about the arts and dance and older people are the Company of Elders, quite a famous company run by Settlers Worlds with very high artistic standards. A whole new festival of dance for older people's dance companies, again created by Sadler's Wells. And we are funding a new initiative that actually comes over from America with the Mark Morris Dance Company in Brooklyn called Dance with Parkinson's. And that's been developed by a man called David Leventhal. And what I think is really interesting about that is, again, you'd say, well, there's very obvious things about dance and people with Parkinson's, about gaze and about posture and about danger of falls and so on. That's all true. But it's not the whole purpose of the exercise. So there was interesting research that was conducted recently about dance with Parkinson's. And the sort of things that the people living with Parkinson's were saying was, I take part in this activity because it makes me feel beautiful. That's not just about whether or not I'm worried about if I'm going to fall over. Because whilst I'm in the class, I'm an artist. It's about their identity. Not just about the physical nature of it. I'll just do 5 minutes at the end about loneliness, because I think a lot of this is really going to be very obvious to quite an expert group such as yourselves. You'll already know about the absolutely massive scale of loneliness as a problem. I think it's a real taboo, loneliness. I think we're all, I certainly speak for myself, I think it's a frightening subject. It's a subject that makes me, I think everyone feels lonely at some points in their lives, but it's also saying, why am I lonely? Why am I unvalued? Why am I unloved? Surely there will be more contact relationships in my life if I was worthy of this. And I think it's a very difficult thing for people to talk about. It's not confined to old people, but it's much more likely to be the case amongst old people. And there's very obvious things about transitions that happen in our lives that will make that more likely. Most obviously, particularly if someone has been in a relationship all their lives, married or whatever, and they lose their partner, that's a profoundly isolating position. There's been lots of research, which I suspect you're aware of, saying that a million people, old people, feel lonely some or all the time. About the tremendous impact that that has on people's health. The latest pieces of medical research suggesting that it's worse for our health than obesity and as bad as smoking when it comes to longevity. So there's this enormous social problem of isolation. And there's many aspects to that, of course. I mean, there's huge isolation also felt by carers of older people. There's interrelationships between these things that if you're suffering from dementia, that's also can be very isolating and to exacerbate that loneliness that you're feeling. I think, I suspect that this audience isn't really going to need much conversing about the role of the arts in reducing social isolation and loneliness, and many of you will either be aware of examples or actually be working on them yourselves. I just noticed that sometimes I just wonder if it ought to be more explicit and if it has implications for the practice of artists and art organisations. So I noticed I've written a little pamphlet that you've got. And one of the reasons I wrote it was I noticed when I was going to see the artists that we were funding, they would of course talk about the art that they created with older people. And indeed they are participatory artists, so they are people who by their training, by their work, think about involvement of different groups of people. But they would talk to me about the art they produced, and the older people would almost, without exception, talk about the relationships which they had developed through the process of whatever. It actually didn't really matter what the form of art was. Any form of art has the potential to be participatory and is an interaction. That we're going to fund is going to be an interaction between an older person creating art and a professional artist. But I think there are practice implications for artists about the time that they're spending in not always on the art, but in a relationship, communicating about the way in which the art event is staged and very obvious things about making time for conversation, about making it celebratory, about making sure there's lots of moments for that communication that isn't just solely focused on the production of the art, and about the longevity of the art, that it needs to be a relationship that develops and continues. I'm sure they're all thoughts that you've already had, but hopefully you can have a discussion where we tease some more than that.
Thank you very much. Sharon, you've had a presentation with some images.
So I was going to talk a bit first and then
Images,
if that's okay. Just at the end so you can see some of them.
Please do, yes.
So I'm from an organisation called Arts for Health Milton Keynes. Arts for Health Milton Keynes has been around for 11 years now, and it grew out of the Voluntary Arts Committee at the Hospital in Milton Keynes. And I think it sort of grew quite quickly, so the hospital's about 30 years old now, And right from the very beginning, they had like an art collection, and we were very lucky because there's some consultants who valued art. But as that grew, it became important that we became like an independent charity. So we've been an independent charity based in Hospital for 11 years now. We initially, the work was all around art in hospital, commissioning work, maybe doing some workshops, doing temporary exhibitions and things like that, which is all very valuable. But then about 6 years ago, after doing actually quite a lot of work on feasibility study, we got some funding for an arts on prescription programme. And for the last 6 years, we've been running this arts on prescription programme. We don't do it in the hospital. I think that's quite an important issue to start with, partly because there's not any room, but also because I think it's really important that the people who come in want to access something that's outside a clinical environment, and it would completely change it if it was in the hospital. We used to work it, run it at Milton Keynes Gallery, but the gallery is closed for expansion at the moment, and luckily we then got some funding for our own workshop space. So for the last, since August, we've had our own workshop space, which is really nice. So arts on prescription, we initially advertised it as being workshops, free art workshops on referral for people with mild to moderate mental health issues. That put some people off, so now we talk in terms of stress, anxiety and depression. Our understanding of that is very wide, and we don't ask anyone to explain to us why they need to come, really. Referrals can come through GPs, the hospitals, community workers. We try really hard not to take self-referrals, because what we're running is an art project, and we want to know that people have got some other support, so if ever we're concerned about that person, we've got someone to go to. So we always have, occasionally we'll take self-referrals, but only if people really can't find someone to refer. It's run on as a 10-week programme, so if you get referred, referral comes through to me, and then when we start a new programme, I'll write a letter to you and say, we're starting a new programme, do you want to come along? It's weekly workshops for 10 weeks. And each 10-week programme we change, so it's a different time, because some people might not be able to make a Tuesday, so we run more on Tuesdays that would exclude those people. Occasionally we do evening ones for people who work as well. So it always changes what time, like if it's morning, afternoon, or evening, what day. We invite 15 people to each programme, or we invite about 15 people to each programme, expecting 10 people to attend. And that seems, this is a sort of format that has evolved. It evolved quite quickly, but we've sort of been sticking to it for the last 3 years. And we find that over a year, we get about 75 referrals over a year, but that's increasing all the time, actually. And then we can run 5 programmes, that's the aim. And they sort of overlap, so just as one finishes, we start another programme. They're all very sort of relaxed and social for the workshops. We don't ask people why they're there. Like the referrals, we ask a little bit of information, but only really for monitoring, or if there's something that people think that they really need to know about. We try really hard to put the onus on referrals to the people referring and explain it's run by artists, we're not therapists. They should be happy that that person is ready to come on the programme. So when people arrive, it's all very relaxed, and people get teas and coffees and things like that. We don't talk to people why they've come, but there's something very nice about everybody knows that there's a reason that everyone else is there, so they don't necessarily know what their problems are, but they know that everyone has got some sort of issue that's meant that they've come to a workshop. It's run quite like an adult ed art lesson, and it's about technique and skills, and this is about making sure that people at the end of the sessions have something they can feel really proud of. It's not about expression. We're not asking them to talk about their, you know, express their feelings in their art. But also that's really absorbing, because it takes a lot of concentration. So, and we find that this really works. So the artists, it tends to be painting and drawing. Sometimes we might do a bit of clay work and printmaking. We like printmaking as well. But it's, Yeah, it's a very set technique per session, really. Many people might work on this project over 3 weeks or something. And people are free. If people don't want to do that, we'd always say, oh, that's fine, you can go and do your own thing or whatever, but on the whole, people do sort of might want to, they want to be told what to do, they want to learn something. And over those 10 weeks, you can see a real difference in the people who attend. We do get lots of people who are referred through social isolation. Like our case studies show that people have not been like really out of the house much in 10 years, 4 years. And the first session, it's really interesting, you compare the first session to the 10th session, and there's a completely different, like, you can't shut them up in the 10th session. The first session, you think, no, like, can you talk, please? They're all feeling really nervous. I think once they've got through that draw in that first session, and they've enjoyed it, realise that they're not alone, they're not the only one feeling like that, then they come back for all the 10 sessions. And they have like wonderful work that they can feel very proud of. The thing in terms of social isolation that people, or and sort of maybe depression as well, that people talk about as being very positive, is having something to do during the week. And that people talk about having a reason to get out of bed. And I think that's all like really positive. And probably I didn't understand that before we started doing this work, and it's interesting what people tell us. But just having something once a week, I mean, they often say, oh, we wish it was more than once a week, but just something once a week that they're coming to is really sort of positive for them. We have the referrals, as I say, it's like, we talk about stress, anxiety and depression. We've actually started having a lot of referrals through pain management and also cancer patients recently. And this is particularly to do with some people in the hospital who know the work that we do and really value it. And obviously, because any physical health issue it might have an impact on your mental health, so you know those things are all like appropriate. But the pain management, the value of the distraction of doing art for pain management seems to be really strong. And we do get, like, we're inundated with people through pain management who want to take part. We don't do any selection of the groups, so it's just 15 referrals come land on my desk, and then I send out the invites to the next program. So we always have a very mixed group. It's very diverse in terms of age, background, reasons that they're there. And that, I think that creates something really special, because you wouldn't normally put those 10 people, 15 people in a room together, and you get them there, and they're making friends with people that they wouldn't normally talk with. And there's like one young person that, like, he's young compared. A lot of the referrals are quite of older people, probably sort of 40 plus. But we do have a few people maybe like in their 20s who come to us. And I can think of one young person who talks a lot about how he never thought he could have anything in common with older people, and how now he knows that he can talk to people, and it's made such a difference to his life because he's realised that. We started getting referrals for people with dementia to Art Song Scripture, and we realised that actually the 10-week program didn't really work for them because they needed more support. So we worked with an extra care village to run some dementia workshops as a sort of pilot to see dementia, what could we do. And I think probably after the first session we realised that we needed loads of volunteers because just about everybody needed one-to-one support. We were really lucky and we managed to get some like really good volunteers who helped us, and we worked with three different artists running like weekly workshops for people with dementia, and they put in an exhibition on at the end of the three projects. And I think like we sort of discovered something there, and we thought, oh, this works, but how on earth are we going to continue this, because we need to have one-to-one support for these people. And I think the only way that I could see that we could do it was through volunteers. And so what we did through the Do Good Feelgood programme was to bring in a volunteer programme manager for a year to help us set up a project where we would recruit associate artists to work with people with dementia. And what the associate artists, so at the moment we have 12 associate artists working with us. They're all volunteers, and they're a mix of professional artists, but also people who have gone through our own Art Song Description programme. Because people who've done the Art Song Description are often quite talented. And they also are they're really keen to give something back, and this is a chance for them to do that. And they are skilled artists, So that, and because they've been through the programme and they know how we work anyway, they're really good at helping out in workshops. So since January, I think, we've been running the dementia workshops with this Do Good Feel Good model, where we have 12 associate artists. We're running 3 sessions a week at the moment. They're all very small, so we have like about, we probably don't have more than 5 people with dementia in the room at the time, because we can probably, the room that we use has probably a maximum capacity of 15 to feel comfortable. If you have any more than that, it gets a bit like crazy and you think, I don't want to be here. And like we always try and remember that we're trying to create something calm and therapeutic. And I sort of didn't know if this would work, having a team of volunteers, helping people with dementia, whether we could get the commitment from people, how people would, you know, it's asking a lot of some people who've just gone through an arts subscription program to then say, can you support someone else? But it's actually been worked really, really well, which is why we now run 3 sessions. And there's actually really good relationships building up between the participants and the artists. And at the moment, they're working towards an exhibition, and they're working on, like, so it's a bit like collaborative work. Sometimes somebody with dementia might be able to like get on and do their own work just with a bit of support, but they have one person, they have an artist sat next to them who can help them through it. And sometimes they need a lot of support, and they need someone to sort of be talking to them all the time about what they need to do. But it's a model that seems to have worked really well, so hopefully we're going to continue. But I want to show you some work that they produced. I just thought it was quite interesting to see the sort of some of the techniques, because we have this pool of artists. The artists come together every now and again to share ideas of what they can do in the sessions. And this is a really nice collaborative piece by one of the associate artists and one of the a man with dementia who comes to the workshop. And these are just squares of tissue paper that they're pasting on. And they do it together, so it's a very joint thing, deciding where the squares might go and making a mess with glue. So we do lots of monoprinting, which works really well, because we use like photocopies to trace over and pick up the ink. But I think what we're quite keen on is techniques which are easy, but we really want, we don't want to be patronising. We want the people who take part to be able to feel proud of what they do. And we've noticed a difference, like some people started like being really a bit hesitant and now like saying, can I take that piece of work home and I want to like frame it or something like that. It was the Queen's birthday, we did some monuments around the Queen. This is interesting, so we have people who do come from like residential homes who come to the dementia workshops and they come with the carers who work in the home. And this is a portrait done by the carer of the person with dementia. So it might even be that the person with dementia might not do much art in the session, but that conversation and talking about it and being part of that is like very important. And you know, the people that come from the homes do say it's really important to get out of the homes and the change of environment. This is a bit more, bubble wrap printing, which with stencils, which works well. I think these are paintings which were done, this is someone who's been coming for a while, and these are paintings done with twigs as well and sticks, and some brushwork, but also using twigs and sticks to sort of try and get over the barriers of people feeling about painting. But I think these two paintings are absolutely beautiful, I love them, and this person has been coming with the people from the home that he comes from say that he's really changed just by having 2 hours a week of art. He used to be quite violent, and he's just become a lot calmer person, which is amazing. Can I just say one thing I've forgotten to say, which is, so at the end of the 10-week programme, thinking about social isolation, we realised that we couldn't just say to people, right, that's it, your 10 weeks is up, you need to go. And that became a real problem for us. And so what we've done is set up an art club. So people who've done the 10-week programme can come to our workshop space and do art on a weekly basis. And we started off doing one art club. Now we've got so many people, it's 2 art clubs. We've got people who've been coming like maybe, well, since I've been there, say 5 years. But they can drop in and out, so it's sort of just an understanding that if ever you've done an art subscription, if ever you want to come to art club, it's there for you, come along. And that seems to work really well. But yeah, it's become a bit of a monster.
Fantastic, thank you very much. I know I've got some questions, but I might save those until the end and give other people here a chance. If anyone would like to ask a question, Sharon or David, please feel free.
Sharon, would it be possible to visit one of your workshops?
Yes,
so, yeah.
You might be made to do some art.
That's what she wants to do.
I think
so. I can explain it better to the people who want to.
Yeah,
I think first hand experience. Mm. Then.
And I have to say, often when we do any events talking about the project, we normally do an art activity so that people get to see what it's really like.
Yeah.
Because I think until you've done that, you don't really understand.
Yeah.
But yeah, as long as they take arrangements.
Yeah, we just go through.
I can give you a card.
Lovely, thank you. So when you run the art club, do you have somebody there with the people to turn up? Do you provide all the materials and they do the whole thing?
We do a mix. So we sometimes have one of the art clubs. We never have an artist apart from we have someone. I might be there, or someone else who works for us about is there, and so they can help out. But we don't set projects. It started off initially that we would have an artist there all the time, but basically I think we're trying to sort of get people to sort of let go a bit and to be more independent about their art. So one art club we don't have an artist at all, the other art club we have an artist every other week. We're probably going to stop doing that now and probably change it a bit, because it's really interesting when there's an artist there, then the group are very demanding, and but actually when the artist isn't there, they're quite capable of getting on and doing their own stuff and like doing really nice things. We provide materials, but people do bring materials as well. But yeah, it's a very sort of like open to go and help yourself to paper, do whatever you want. A few health and safety issues that we sometimes have to take care of.
Can I ask you about how you evaluate your programmes? The phrase has been used that, you know, we get what we measure, and we've been talking as an organisation about how difficult it can be to measure the things that are important. Often they're the most difficult. How do you find a balance between sort of delivery, funding and measurement, you know, evaluation of the programmes? Good question.
It's a topic which we find quite difficult when I've been having to think about it. Today, I had a colleague who, in exasperation when trying to join me, evaluate something, said, let's not make a religion out of it. And I do think he's right, and that all too often we do make a religion out of it. What we try and do as a basic principle is we've given a certain amount of money to an organisation, so there is a moral case that they need to show that they've spent that money in a way that fits our charitable purposes. Mm-hmm. But that's pretty minimal. Then beyond that, I think we get into some very difficult problems. And we fund lots of really different things. And we try to look at them on a case-by-case basis. The first thing is that if it is at all possible, and it's a bit holier than thou, we want the monitoring and evaluation to be an opportunity for the, in this case, the arts organisation, to think itself, how could we have done this better? How did it go? And if we were to do this again, how can we improve on what we've done before? I think the whole question of, there's then, I think, something that's fairly straightforward, that as we are looking at the happiness and relationships between people, it would be quite often in these sorts of cases that there'd be some sort of evaluation at the beginning and at the end, and people would be asked, you know, how are you feeling? I mean, you know, how you do this And there's certainly been lots of that for arts and health projects, sometimes in an extremely detailed way. And again, I'm going to defer to you, but I think it's Warwick, Edinburgh. There's a special series of tests that are used for psychological well-being. You know, and that's I don't think they're that difficult. It's in a way, and I don't have a professional background to know how well regarded they are, but you can ask people what was your experience about this like. And then I think there's a final level, and we've just been talking about arts and health, where I do think there's a worry that it's becoming a religion, where we're constantly being told about randomised control trials as the gold standard for what should be done. They of course cost an absolute fortune, often many times the amount of money that's being spent on the project itself to get to that level of evidence. It would ideally have large numbers of people involved. It's that and Cochrane tests are developed for medicines. Well, absolutely, I think medicines should have randomised controlled trials, thank you, but medicine isn't art. And also we don't need to do it repeatedly. We could use common sense. And there is quite a lot of academic studies already about the benefits of our interest, arts for older people, and the sorts of conditions that older people tend to have, whether it's dementia and so on. We don't need to have one of these big studies every time someone does a project involving people with dementia, because those studies already exist. It does then leave us with a difficulty at the end that some funders like to have lots of very clear numbers. We tend not to have lots of very clear numbers, and we make an assessment about whether we use our judgment about whether or not we think that the money's been well, wisely spent and had the impact. But we feel that's appropriate, particularly when it comes to the arts. We know much. You're on the wrong end of all these evaluations.
When we first started the arts on subscription programme, we did the GAD forms in the PHQs, which is general anxiety and depression and personal health questions, which are similar to the one at the Edinburgh scale. And we did them every single session. And what we found out was that people, we were just doing them too early at the programme because that's what we said we'd do. People thought that depending on how well they were, meant whether they could come back or not. So people were in a real dilemma about like, how well can I get to help them show that it's working, but that they're not going to throw me off the course. And I think then when we discovered this, I think we knew it wasn't really working. But also, I don't know if people know those forms, but like on the GAD form, I think it is. It says something like, "Do you think you'd be better off dead? How many times do you think you'd be better off dead?" And you know, you just had a nice art workshop, and then you get people to fill that form out. And so we stopped doing them completely because we gathered loads. And I think like the evaluation thing is always used as an excuse not to fund things because there is lots of evaluation and evidence out there already. But people come back to us all the time and say, "Oh, you need to, you know, have some evidence." And like we have all these like loads and loads of GAD forms that have been completed, which all show that people improve their health and well-being through attending, but it doesn't make any difference. So we stopped doing that, and what we developed, because what also we realised was that people have got, they're all coming for so many different reasons, they've all got their own journeys. So we developed a postcard that we asked people to complete beforehand and then afterwards, and it had a chance to draw something or collage something, to do a bit of art, and also to write about why they're coming and how they're feeling about coming. And then at the end, they do the same game, so they draw pictures. So also, hopefully, we can show how they've developed art skills, but also how they've, you know, how their health and well-being has improved. And that was all going very well, and it's really nice. But then in the last year, Arts and Prescription has been funded through the mental health pilot with community learning. And that's, I don't know if you know about that, but that's a national pilot and all the schemes have had to use the GAD and PHQ forms again, and other forms as well. And so we've had to go back and use them. And like people talk about, like, you know, when you ask them to fill forms out in the first week, that it could put people off coming back again. And it really changes the whole thing of the workshop. Like, I think we've tried really hard to sort of take that out. They're coming to do something different. And as soon as you start talking about all those things and their problems, it just changes the whole atmosphere. So I don't know if it's good. I think that we're not going to be funded like that in the future. So hopefully we won't have to keep doing those forms, but it is quite often the funders who tell us how we have to evaluate it. What we have done, which I think are really good, is some case study videos and some case studies as well, which are on our website. And I think that thing about reading people's own stories and journeys is what is the most powerful thing about them. Yeah. It's impossible.
I've got a question. Might be a bit of a tricky question, but there is an assumption sometimes that because older people are of a different generation, they might have sensibilities which would put them off producing art, especially something which is outwardly kind of contemporary or conceptual. Do you think that that assumption is founded in any way, or do you reckon that is just prejudice?
Well, I'm extremely in favour of people not producing conceptual art, so.
No, I only said that.
I'm not sure I've got a good answer, Sam, but I do. My instinct would be that it's a question of allowing people to make their own minds up what forms of art they're interested in. First of all, art is not compulsory. So some people aren't going to be attracted to what we're funding to be put on offer, and that's fine. We hope that, you know, we're talking about loneliness, we hope that there's other things in their lives which can also, you know, going for a walk, going bird spotting in a group. There's lots of different ways in which people can develop relationships. It doesn't have to be art. But then, if they are choosing art, for most of the things that we're funding, I would suspect that the arts organisation would want to share a range of different opportunities, which would, I mean, I'm thinking about visual arts now, but if we're talking about, say, choirs in care homes, it's definitely the case that the project that we're funding is talking about what's a broad repertoire that people can be introduced to, which could be, you know, ethnically very diverse, in style very diverse, and in chronologically diverse about when pieces were created.
Would you say, to an extent, it's about giving people the respect and the agency to decide what they like and allowing them to pursue that, not kind of pushing a standard on them?
I wish I had said that. How about you?
I don't think it's age related at all. I spent a lot of time defending conceptual art with like all our participants. Like they talk very negatively about things that they've seen on telly, you know, Milton Keynes Gallery. And I think what people have to understand is, or what we have to understand, is that people need a way in, and actually we can do that. And it's like, once you think, a lot of people come to us and they will say they're rubbish at art, they don't know anything about it, and we'll say, right, everyone thinks that for a start, you'll be fine by the time you get to the end of the 10-week program. And once they find their own place, and then they become more confident about discussing things, and more open to ideas, I think. And when we were running our workshops at Milton's Gallery, it was very good, because we could then say, let's go to the gallery and have a look at what's in there. And they could talk about it with their friends and things like that. I don't think, I've noticed, I would say older people are just as open to ideas, and I don't think I've ever thought
there's a difference, I don't think. I think just generally people.
He was very naughty there, wasn't he? Because he said contemporary and conceptual art, as if they were.
As if they are one and the same.
And not all contemporary art is conceptual. Conceptual art is increasingly rather old fashioned, I think.
I have a feeling that actually, when older people have a way in, they are actually very open because they don't, they're women and really clear about opinions and they're not really worried about people.
And it's brilliant for people with dementia, like, because like what we always say is there's no right or wrong in art, so like, you know, you can talk about something and whatever people, however they feel about it, that's okay. So as a person with dementia, you don't have to think, oh, I can't remember. It's just whatever that response is at that time.
And I was going to ask about that. What were the biggest differences that you saw in working with groups with people with dementia to working with
I think that the memory thing, so we couldn't run a workshop in the same way. So normally in a workshop someone would do it a bit of a demonstration and then say, oh, we'll get on and do it. And people with dementia wouldn't be able to do that. They need someone to sit by them and talk through every single step with them and remind them of those things. Some people need to be like shown where the paint pot is and things like that. So I think like dementia is a vast thing, isn't it? And the people that come to our workshops, some of them need a lot of support and some of them don't need so much, or need different types of support. But I think what's interesting is that something that I heard one of the volunteers say the other day was, because we did some training for people in this. She was saying that when we did our training, we were told that people with dementia can't learn anything new. And she said they've all learned something new. And you can see that, they've developed, and they do remember things from the previous week. So,
So were they new workshops, or were they an adaptation of the same sort of workshop?
So it's, I think we do some of the same activities, just we have like a set of activities that we do, because some of the associate artists have done the arts and description programme, they will have remembered things. But actually, we sent all the associate artists out to come back, to think about ideas and to come back. And we did a big sharing day where they sort of shared ideas with the other associate artists and then decided what they thought would work. So we've adapted things. But I think also what's interesting is I think some of the ideas that have been in the dementia workshops, the artists run in their arts and description program and see, and they say, oh, that's a good idea, I'm going to try that. So there's like a real crossover.
I have two things to the point about dementia. Quite a lot of our funding is in care homes, and everyone here will know that if you're doing an arts project in a care home, you really need to assume that most of the people involved are going to be living with dementia, and be, whether or not it's called, whether it's unlikely to be dementia specialist care home, whatever nature of care home it is, most people will have some type of dementia to some degree. And then the other thing that, so all those artists are having to think through what the possibilities are, enormous amounts of possibilities. The other thing that we haven't talked about much, and we mainly fund participatory art, where older people are creating art pieces themselves, including people living with dementia. But I think being an audience member is interesting too, and shouldn't be forgotten. I always think, well, most of my life in the arts is being an audience member, and why shouldn't we be thinking about that as well? And there's a big programme of activity throughout the country, often based on what's called Meet Me at NOMA, which you've probably heard of, which is the programme that was developed at a Museum of Modern Art in Manhattan, and is specifically for people living with dementia to experience, absolutely your point, to be talking about any form normally visual art. Sometimes it's museum, art museums and historical museums as well. But for people with dementia to be able to to appreciate, to think about, to comment on works. I went to just a session of this at the Royal Academy, and it was very interesting. I thought they did it very brilliantly. And of course, Royal Academy is absolutely fantastic, gorgeous, wonderful building, so there's a feeling of occasion, and people are coming in from the community to a marvellous place, to be treated very well, lots of conversation, lots of involvement for them. And then the thing that I'm sure was obvious to everyone, but really struck me is, well, I was going in with a lady, and in a very stupid way, and I was trying to make a conversation in a very naked way, and I said, so where have you come from today? And there was this, you know, awful pause, because she couldn't remember where she lived. I felt terrible that I'd done something so stupid. But then when she was in the group, she was a changed person. And she's actually one of the liveliest people in the group, because it's all about being in the moment and commenting on the piece of art that she was being shown and being asked questions about and appreciating, and I found that very moving.
And the MoMA project, it does a lot about carers, doesn't it? So
absolutely
people go as a couple maybe,
absolutely,
and they talk
right.
about how it's nice for them to just do something normal together, something shared together, isn't it? So, and to stop maybe being a carer, but they're equal in that moment, aren't they? So.
That kind of brings me to my question, which is that people have an emotional engagement with the arts of whatever type, contemporary or otherwise. But people with mental health issues and dementia, we tend to medicate emotion out of the picture. So how do people emotionally engage with art through your programmes?
I think people do emotionally engage very well. I don't know how. I probably, I just don't know, but I've never noticed that they haven't been able to.
So the point is that there's an assumption, and particularly presumably for some of the people that you're working with, that they are using medication, and that will in some way reduce the quality of their engagement or their emotional response with what they're doing.
Yeah, I've never thought about that, and I've never noticed
it. It's an interesting question.
So, yeah. I think what is interesting on medication, I think, is because I think one of our aims at the beginning was to get people to reduce their medication, and actually people need to be on medication sometimes, and that's never going to be achievable. But someone talked about how medication was something that people wanted to come off of, but when you give them art, they just want more of it, which I think is really lovely, isn't it? So,
I wondered if it was the difference between engaging emotionally with people and engaging emotionally with things or experiences, because people feel isolated because of their conditions and emotionally withdrawn, and medication leaves them flat and unable to engage in that way with people. But with art, it's almost an instinctive response. I like that, I don't like that, I don't understand that, that really speaks to me. And I wondered if that was how the programmes broke through that barrier of medication.
I think what does break through is the fact that everybody is there. People aren't judged at all, and people don't have to pretend they're okay.
Yeah.
And so if people have a bit of a wobble or whatever, everyone is really, really supportive. And so I think there is a sort of people are relaxed, and that they do feel comfortable enough to say what they feel. That's how I'm going to look out for that.
Thank you. We've got a question from our online audience. So Simon Wollum is an artist, and he says he picks up on the significant role of stories and journeys, and he's interested in collaboratively generating narrative by walking physically and virtually from a childhood home, and
the discussions then are guided through that journey, giving a participant the lead in where he wanders with them. And he's asking, his question is, do you know of any current research around how talking and walking is beneficial to older people and also engagement with digital media could enhance this process?
I don't, it's a really interesting question, isn't it? I'm sorry I haven't got the answer.
That sounds a wonderful project, doesn't it?
there was mention earlier of a project involving running and the health benefits of running to older people. I can't remember who it was. But we were talking about running roles for older people.
Mm-hmm. As opposed to walking, but
it's a question with lots of different elements to it, mm-hmm. isn't it? Because I think there was something about reminiscence or narrative.
So I think he gives people the option that either they can take a physical walk
or
it could be a virtual walk, so they watch using, I don't know whether it's some kind of technology like Google Maps, but they can take a walk through observing a journey online together and discuss it and talk about what they might see or experience. So he works with those who are more and less mobile. Mm. Mm.
There is some problem of mobility, especially with people as they get gradually older. One of the questions I wanted to ask is, we've talked a lot about gallery visits and workshops based in towns and cities, but evidence suggests that actually being situated in a rural environment, how it exacerbates the impacts on health brought about by loneliness. So I think it's a dilemma, but how does one, you know, make these provisions accessible to people who are rurally based and perhaps don't have access to transport?
I'm going to do rural in a moment. I'll just tell you one for the sort of most extraordinary example of this sort of thing that the artist online was talking about, a virtual journey, is that we funded the Serpentine Gallery, and they did a whole series of projects with people in care homes, but also in a hospice. And the artist, whose name, to my irritation, I'm forgetting, but it might be on Serpentine's web. Website has a practice of working with individuals, and this gentleman was terminally ill and couldn't leave his room, and they were talking about visits, and this chap said, oh well, the thing I always wanted to do, and I regret that I'm now not going to do it, is go down the Amazon. So the artist went down the Amazon for him and took photos and did a sort of video diary and the whole thing, and then brought coming back to the Amazon as a gift for this man in the last month of his life. You're right, I don't think we think enough about rural provision, but I mean it's a problem. It is particularly a problem for older people, and older people are more likely to be living in rural locations, also particularly likely to be living in particular coastal communities, a number of which are doing rather badly, and often are less well served by arts organisations. I think it doesn't fit in that well, possibly, with the issue of loneliness, I'm not sure. But I mean, an obvious answer is about digital technology, and we've got several reports on our website about digital art. We're about to have a new partnership that will have more funding for digital arts and older people. And it's interesting, in a very short space of time, a lot of this was looking at care homes, how in 2011, when you were looking at care homes, they were saying, well, actually this is really difficult, and very little access to the internet, really poor connections, staff themselves don't have access to computer, you can't, there's very little opportunity in most places. And then we're about to have this new program in 2016, it seems to me that iPad has revolutionized that situation, and also it's much more instinctive. So there's now a series of digital arts projects with older people, some of which are taking place in care homes, including one, for instance, called iPad Engage. There's lots more on our website about this. So I think that's at least a possibility of breaking down isolation. The thing that you've already mentioned, the Arts Council of Northern Ireland programme that we're part funding, they are particularly interested in rural communities and rural isolation, because obviously that's the nature of Northern Ireland. There are many. Yes. It is quite a rural country, and they've funded specific projects, and it strikes me that, you know, the Arts Council is more alive to it. But you know, I think the need is 100 times greater than the provision.
I was very pleased to hear that your workshops cover a wide range of age groups, because I don't like to think of the elderly as being seen as separate from the rest of society. Mm-hmm. They're as diverse a group as everybody else. But the thing that occurred to me, thinking about that, was do you have an equal number of men and women? Because in my work, with the befriending service for older people, it's been my experience that when you visit men, they will say things like, I was at a low ebb when I said to the GP that I felt a bit lonely, but I'm all right now, I don't really want to volunteer. I've never found a woman to say that, and I'm not sure if it's because we advertised the befriending service as a cup of tea and a chat, which is very much a female thing. Generally, men don't go around to a friend's house for a cup of tea and a chat, as women do. So I wasn't sure if you find...
By far, the majority of referrals are women.
Yes.
So normally in the group, we might, of 10 people, we might have two or three men. Sometimes no men at all. And it's really interesting, because I always think, oh, are they going to feel really uncomfortable? Because there's just, they're just single man in the group, but actually I think it always like works out fine and it's okay. But it is, I think it sort of follows figures follow this sort of because men are not very good at seeking help for mental health problems, are they? So I think the sort of ratio we have probably follows the amount of women that would seek help as well. So yeah. But it's very interesting. We do get a really, the diversity of the groups, I think, is something that is really, really lovely, and within that, the age range is, you know, so we've had people as young as 18 come, and people up to 80 being referred, but having them all in the room together, working together, is really nice.
Shall I just pick up on that point about, in our case, older men, and you are absolutely right, and it isn't very much an issue for the arts projects that we fund. We did specifically fund a report on engaging older men in the arts, because it's so obvious that it is more difficult to do that. And there's a really nice report by a guy who works in the Whitworth Gallery in Manchester that goes through a series of suggestions. It's a very beautiful report, and it's extremely well done. But I think you put your finger on it, because one of the things he talks about is that the arts, if it's properly, as it were, marketed, if it's properly explained, are quite good because you're doing something. And it's not just what
yes,
men, of course,
well,
are. So.
See.
And also giving is very, yes, is very important, that people, particularly old men, do want to do something and to give something, and often they want, so a lot of these programs are trying to emphasize volunteering, that men were contributing
to it. Actually, sort of rather stereotypically, some things were more attractive to men than other things. And these are stereotypes, but they tended to be more interested in a bit, good bit of kit. So if there's a nice digital photography corpse, it's something to fiddle with. And also technical, you know, technical drawing and draftsmanship. And there's, I think there's been some really, we fund lots of work in museums, and museums actually can be extremely good ways of bringing, engaging older men. So there's a whole series of technical museums that they might be more attracted to. I think, I remember seeing a film of some, which was a psychological experiment, and it was in the, I think it was in the 50s, so it was children 5 or 6, perhaps 7 years old, who would now be older people, and it's in America. I can't imagine that it would be any different. And they filmed little girls together, suddenly introduced and to play with toys and their interaction. And the girls would sort of look at the toys a bit and say, and then immediately introduce themselves and start talking about which school are you in. And the boys often wouldn't exchange names, just like banging the toys at each other. And it, I'm not sure we've got any better in 50 years since then.
Going back to that board, not so cut off,
yes.
Part-funded with Arts Council of Northern Ireland,
yeah.
That mentions explicitly that social isolation seems to affect older men slightly more, whereas statistically women tend to live to be older, and I wondered whether that's something which you considered possibly if groups of women were living to be older, they are, you know, those social circles are remaining intact for a longer period of time, or is it possibly just an attitude of not wanting to stay in touch?
Well, personally, I think it's all those things. It is the way in which we're all socialised. I think women are much better at relationships.
Well, no, I just think that, yeah, I think just from my observations, women would be making friends more, and yeah, and like within our groups, that happens all the time, you know, the women are all organising to go out somewhere or do something, you know, whereas men probably don't.
I mean, and then when you have a situation where, quite a typical couple where a woman has died before the man, then there is tremendous isolation.
No woman to
organise the relationship. Yeah. It's true.
So I had a question about going back to arts on prescription. Actually, so one of the things I think it was for the workshop, so the regularity of it was what people really craved. They said they wish it could be more than once a week, and actually just kind of having a one-off session is nice, but not sometimes it's not kind of adequate treatment. In the case of delivering activity like that in a rural setting where transport or access has to be thought about, how do you say that can be dealt with?
So we have very few issues to do with people being able to access your workshops. And I think where the workshop is based, it's on like good bus links, so that's like quite good. And there's free parking, which is all part of like what we were thinking about. In the early days, people could claim for travel expenses to get to our subscription. And some people would, and some people wouldn't. And I was never sure whether the people who really needed to were the people who were claiming, so that sort of concerned me a bit. And I think like the month we weren't able to continue to do that because we didn't have the funding, and occasionally people ask that. So I think like very occasionally people say, we can't get there, and then we try and help them either by talking about community transport or something like that. But I can think of some people at the moment, a couple who are coming to the dementia project, who say they can't afford the bus, and we tried really hard to support them to get on community transport, and it's just impossible. There's like a massive waiting list or something.
When you say community transport, do you mean like a carpooling system or a minivan?
That plus bus. In Milton Keynes it's called a plus bus, so cheating and stuff. So they're like, they're minivans, which if you're a disabled person, you can sign up to the scheme and then it will pick you up and drop you off. But it's not like going to a bus stop, it will come to where you are and to your door and take you home. So you might go on a very long journey home, dropping other people off. There is, so it's being cut back. Yeah. But that's it, so that, I think that's that's a bit of an issue. And I think we try really hard. I think we make ourselves available to chat to people, so say if ever there's an issue, look, why you can't attend, let us know and we'll see what we can do. We can't promise anything, but, you know, we might be able to find a solution. In terms of the regularity of the workshops, I think so many people have said to me that it was just they needed something, some structure in their week and something to do. And I think maybe, you know, you're suffering from chronic pain and you're not able to work anymore and suddenly so much of your life has disappeared. And people were saying that they wouldn't get out of bed, and yet having something in their week that they haven't had to do.
So the social elements and the participation really is key.
Yeah, having to be somewhere at a certain time. And I always say to them, it's fine if you can't make it. You don't have to ring me or anything. But they all want to tell me that they can't make it, and because it's really important to them, and they feel like they should be there. And I think we see it quite casually, but they don't see it casually at all.
Because it's a fixture of
really important to them. And interestingly, the art club, one of the art clubs, we run on a Monday morning, and I think that's really good because that's when everyone else is getting ready to go to work. People who come to the Monday morning art club, they've got something to do as well, and so it gets their week off to a really good start. I didn't think about that, that just happened quite accidentally, but you just think, oh yeah, that's quite interesting.
Do you see any informal spin-offs as well, where people will say, we'll get together when the 10 weeks is finished and do some art together, or where people perhaps are going to make sure they do something at home, they get the stuff together that they need? And
people buy, they do their own projects at home. They, interestingly, this morning at the art club we had this morning, three of the women were talking about how they didn't see an exhibition together over the weekend and how they wanted to invite everyone else along. So I think they were sort of hoping that I might organise it, but I said, you organise it. And so I said, you could be our social secretary and you sort it out. And they were all like exchanging contact details and things like that. And that's really nice. And that's what I think, our problem is that we can't sustain what we've got going on because we've got more and more people coming to art club.
Yeah.
And so we really, really want them to go out and experience other art opportunities and to go to other venues. But they do sort of have a real sense of loyalty to us, and also they do feel really comfortable with us, so they do, I don't think.
Do you think there's another kind of element that could help with that sustaining? I'm just thinking of some kind of minimal input that would just keep people in contact and organising things themselves beyond the 10 weeks?
Yeah.
Is there another kind of...
I think because they're at the art club, and that used to have an artist, and now we're saying, no, we're not going to have an artist, you're just going to have to come. And we used to just run that once a fortnight, but then we could never remember which week it was on, so we do everything else, otherwise there's a danger that I'm not going to be there. And but I think, trying to sort of, we're talking about setting that up as a membership scheme, so people become members and they get to use the studio space. But then we also have programmes that they can take part in, or like on visits and things like that. So I think there is definitely.
Because it just feels like you are kind of kicking off something really positive, and it could be something that will carry on. But I know what it's like, often the kind of momentum dies, doesn't it?
Yeah.
And people just perhaps lapse back into how it was before.
But we've had like people been here for 5 years.
Yeah.
It's like, but it's just growing. But we have talked to other venues in Milton Keynes, and like I think if we got funding, what we would like to do is to sort of try and then. Help people access services at other venues, and so
I think that's the other one, isn't it? That because you bring a group of people together, we've got particular needs, but they could be tapping into evening classes or whatever that just happened.
Yeah.
So then you're really building on that diversity rather than putting groups of people together.
Yeah, and we do we talk about what's going on in Milton Keynes all the time. And the artists who work with us are sort of always talking about, you know, what are the things they're involved in. So people do
launch pad, isn't it?
Access other things. Yeah. But I think one of the, especially with people in social isolation, if they come to us and they found something they really like, and they become our friends as a result of that, and it becomes really difficult to actually let people go. There's incredible. Sense of responsibility to those people.
Mm-hmm.
But also, I think there is, like, because people maybe don't have that much contact with other people, there's a lot, like in the sessions, they do want to talk a lot, and you do get that sense of, you know, then people aren't seeing other people, and so everything they've got to say to everyone in the whole week is actually said in that workshop. And when it works really well is when they're all supporting each other, so we can't support all those people.
Right.
When you see those sort of support, you know, when people ask, you know, where's so-and-so, she's not here, is she okay, and I want a check-up and things like that, that's lovely.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
you've been very clear from the beginning that your focus is around the arts, but I assume that the staff and the artists have had different kinds of training to understand maybe people's different behaviours or needs, or has that come through developing the programmes that you've developed?
They've all had experience of running workshops with vulnerable adults. They haven't necessarily had any specific training. But also my thought would probably be that the best training you can get is actually doing that work. When we've looked at doing training, we think, well, what can you tell people? Because I have no idea what's going to happen in a workshop from one, you know, the groups are so diverse and, you know, everyone's different and their needs are different. So they're all very experienced. We always have an artist and a workshop assistant in the room. And the assistant is someone who's very experienced as well. And is normally someone who works for Arts for Health, so it might be me, we have a workshop assistant who's normally there, who also happens to be an art therapist, but he's not there as an art therapist. But when people arrive, we do a participatory agreement with them, which is explaining that we're not therapists, and talking to them about how, if they do feel they need some support, they need some time out, they can get that. But the other thing is, especially like doing the well-being questionnaires, we have to be really careful on safeguarding issues. So if people are telling us that they felt like every day in the last week that they were better off dead, we have to report that to someone. So we do take it very responsibly, and it is quite tough. And what we have done in the past is have supervision for artists, so group supervision. To sort of like, so we can like get through any issues that people are feeling. We've started doing creative supervision for the team of volunteer artists, which is quite an exciting project because we have an art therapist who's doing that for us on a voluntary basis. But every 6 weeks she'll do a session with all the volunteer artists, which we have no idea what happens in that session, but that's their supervision time. But I think we've learned a lot in the 5 years, and I think we the artist, like our lead artist, has been with us right from the very beginning. She's very, very experienced. But things like boundaries and things are also an issue.
Mm-hmm.
you have any suggestions as to how you involve the housebound in the arts?
It's really hard. We have had funded occasionally artists to go into people's homes, obviously that needs cooperation of the person themselves, but it's extremely expensive as a form of engagement.
In terms of the number of people who are being engaged for the costs,
yeah.
Is that what you mean?
I think because there are schemes that do that, aren't there, where yes, an artist might work with an individual person and go into their home, which I think would be really nice, but I can't imagine how it could which is,
We've seen funding some things. I sometimes wonder if radio is neglected. So we've been funding some art projects which have been, for instance, specific artworks that are created on radio and then efforts made to make sure that those go, that older people are particularly likely to access them. Or we've been funding older people to in Manchester to be involved in a community radio station called All FM, and they will go to the arts events and theatre and galleries, whatever it is, in Manchester, and they've got their programme about those things, which will then it's a station that's specifically catering for older people. So that's a way of getting into people's homes, including for people that are for people that are housebound. But it's a difficult one.
I don't know if it's helpful as an example. So I did a lot of volunteer befriending people in their own homes of people who are housebound, and finding out that someone can still crochet or put beads together and make necklaces. And I guess that is an example of bringing that to people. But I guess it is down to a good volunteer coordinator or to someone who is helping the volunteers and supporting the volunteers to let them know and train them, or just bring up the idea that that is also something that you can bring into someone's home, just like you might have a chat or talk about events. You can bring that in.
Reminded, and it might have been, not sure it was for Illuminate, but it was for a theatre festival where there was a sort of theatre in a box which were delivered to people who were homebound, and inside there were pieces of textiles from the actors' costumes and information they could read about it, photos, might have been a DVD or a video with a recording of it as well, just for those people who are isolated, can't leave the house, but miss going to the theatre. I don't know what you think. Maybe technology will provide an answer. I mean, a lot is said about how it's kind of a boundary that comes between older people and different generations, but actually, you know, Skype and iPads, and these are examples of technologies which are bringing, you know, people of that generation closer to their relatives and their friends who live far away that they can't visit. Maybe it'll help to the same with the arts.
Well, Skype is being used for art projects, for instance, to link older people in different countries and to create a piece of art together, so I'm sure they
will. I think the RSC have sort of tackled this in part with live streaming of performances in cinemas. But then if you took that a step further, why not live streaming on television? Because then, you know, people are getting that theatre experience, albeit in isolation in their own home. But in a cinema, you're fairly isolated anyway, aren't you? But mostly the rest of the audience irritate you by being for the day
Christmas. It's
also
I think it's a really good point. And we have had, particularly the Arts Council England, and I think in our new programme about digital arts, we keep talking to the larger art companies about live streaming into care homes. And it has been done a little bit. And so you mentioned a project that we're involved with, which is an international one. And I thought they were very clever that the Dutch culture ministry had an evening of older people's art. It was in the capital in The Hague. So it was older artists, mainly community artists, some really fantastic pieces. It was in the presence of the Dutch Queen, actually recently retired Queen, so it's a really major event, it's a royal performance. And I thought they were really smart in then getting that streamed live into care homes in The Hague, so that they could be part of this, even though they weren't actually able to. I thought that was a really clever piece of programming.
Do you think with you, we've trained in this episode, that if that your volunteers could be trained, yeah. Is that a way of doing it?
Yes.
So,
yeah.
Like, maybe.
Yes, like you said, that it's up to volunteers to create something.
But maybe through some sessions where people get to know some sort of really easy techniques or,
We could commission an artist to devise a programme
that
could then do this.
Yeah,
why not?
And then it's possible that people could feel like they were part of something bigger, like people, doing a crochet square that's then links up and they can see that they're doing something, not just on their own, but they are connecting with other people without having to go outside the home.
We actually did that in a care home where they all made the crochet the squares and went off to a dog home as well. That was really good. It was sort of brought everybody out of the rooms. Even men, for instance, or they just watched. It was good. When you're talking about streaming into care homes, would that lead hopefully into schemes where there's community pools, where people live in shelter accommodation, sports accommodation?
Yes.
Because a lot of them use the communal halls, so they have TVs, and a lot of my residents talk about theatre, but it's not always possible for them to get even to the Corby Theatre or to the queue, or to the cinema where they do the live streaming. But they do like things like that, film nights and stream nights. Well, they don't have any stream nights, but a lot of them like theatre and the arts, and even might start theatre group.
That is the hope. It's only been done a little bit so far. And as I understand it, it's about intellectual property and copywriting and the commercialisation of performances. So
you can have a license.
It's quite a big deal, but that's what the Arts Council is trying to
solve.
We've done it. We have done it. So in Nottingham, there's a lovely example. I think music's a good medium. They had a quite a prestigious performance, piano performance, in the Royal Concert Hall, the main venue in Nottingham, and then that was streamed into participating care homes, and the staff made an occasion of it.
Yeah,
because
music's really good as well.
Yeah. I think we're going to call it there. Thank you, guys. Thank you, everyone, very much for coming. And thank you to David and Sharon and Bobby, our guest speakers this month. So, also, I'd like to take the opportunity to thank Martin for being our cameraman and live editor today. And also just to quickly thank Contemporary Visual Art Network East Midlands and also Northamptonshire Community Foundation for their support. We have another event next month on the topic of art and astronomy. There is a poster on the wall over there. Tickets are selling out very fast. I think we've probably only got about five left. That's taking place on the 20th. From 7 until 9 p.m. Thank you very much. Thank you.